was just so I didn't forget to give it to you. Because I have that short-term memory issue. And turn that over. Sarah wanted to announce that during the announcements.
Okay.
We're going to have to figure out some way to get it there, because that's right in the middle of our Seder.
Okay. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Everybody wide awake and ready to go?
Yes.
Well, at least some of you are. I am not. We had a great time last night at the chili cook-off. Anybody want to guess who took first place? Do we have any doubts?
No.
Knowing that our senior pastor has the ability to not only be a great senior pastor, but a great cook as well. She did really good. Second place was tied for Sarah and Phyllis. And that was the evening. It was a great night. I actually took home the bronze, but if you do the math, I won third place. I medaled.
Thousands of people never medaled.
Yeah, I got a medal. We all got medals. It was a fun night by all, and very, very grateful for it.
How much did we make, sir?
Yes, I was going to ask.
And we raised $224 for Rippling Hope.
Woo!
Yeah. Woo!
That's pretty good for a church this size. It's pretty good for anybody, really, a lot of times. Okay, and announcements. Don't have the bulletin because I forgot to grab one. Thank you. Okay, this year, Monday, Thursday. This year on Monday, Thursday, we will be holding a Seder dinner. I will be looking for readers and cooks, so be prepared. That's from her, not me. April 6th and 7th. April 6th at 7 p.m. Because it happens to happen at sundown.
Which is actually 8 o'clock.
Well, we're fudging it. It's going to be sundown somewhere.
We're a bunch of Christians having a Seder, okay? I think we can bend the rules.
And what time is it?
6 o'clock on April 6th.
7 o'clock
on April 6th.
April 6th, that is Monday, Thursday.
7 o'clock.
Just remember, 6 at 7. The contracts for the vendor show are available. If you know anyone who'd be interested, or if you are interested, please let Kelly know and get signed up quickly because space is filling. There will be a Mother's Day tea on May 13th at 1 p.m. Mothers, grandmothers, great-grandmothers, daughters, aunts, nieces are invited to attend. We will be serving tea and goodies. Join us for the celebration of women who brought us into the world and threatened to take us out. That's actually on here, but I know the feeling. May is a very busy month for us because we have on the 6th, not the 6th.
Yeah.
The 6th, we have the vendor show.
Right.
I just told you about the Mother's Day tea. And then the next Saturday, which I forget the date right this minute. 20th. We will be having a baby shower here for Lita, Renea, Brianne, Lo, mother's last name was Schreer. So for my grandbaby and her mommy and daddy, we'll be here, we're gonna celebrate it. I will be getting her, she has a baby listing on Amazon, but as she's reminded me several times after watching a video and going, oh my God, I didn't know they used that many diapers. Diapers and wipes will be greatly appreciated as well. And the consistory meeting will be after church on Palm Sunday. And I think that's all the announcements. Anybody have anything I forgot? Oh, yeah, this baby shower.
Yeah,
I forgot. It was right there in front of me. I was told about it, and I apologize. I got so excited about my grandbaby. National Association of Negro Business and Professional Women's Clubs Incorporated, Detroit Club, invites you to attend a drive-by 32nd annual community baby shower to benefit Henry Ford's Hospital's community babies. Thursday, April 6th from 5:30 p.m. to 7 p.m. Located at Henry Ford Hospital West Pavilion entrance. Enter the main driveway off of Grand Boulevard. It's all here in this paper, which I'm assuming will be on the back table.
It is.
Okay. And West Grand Boulevard and all that. So all the information's on the back. So what you're going to do is you're going to drive by, drop off your baby stuff, and then come here.
Actually, we're going to collect it here and take it down
actually,
at one time.
Probably one of us is going to do that. And I'll be happy. If
okay.
You just bring it to church on Palm Sunday.
Okay.
That would work.
For those of you who might not have heard that or at home, if you will get it to church by Palm Sunday, Miss Sarah will take it down for the baby shower. Right?
And they're looking for newborn-sized items. So if you're like me and you typically buy 6 to 9 month stuff for baby showers, back it up and go ahead and buy the newborn stuff. Because these babies are probably coming into the world without a whole lot at home waiting for them. So, also, Easter lilies. Kathy will be getting Easter lilies to decorate the altar for Easter. They will be $10 a piece. And if there isn't a sign up sheet out there already, there will be.
There is a sign-up
sheet. I actually remembered something. Yay for me.
I just need
a better than me.
By next Sunday. So, yes.
Okay, so think about it fast and sign up and get the money to Kathy. Jim?
Thank you.
What do you got?
The Sunday school is going to be having an Easter egg hunt this year.
Yay.
So if you can bring in a bag of candy, small pieces that will fit inside the egg, be nice by Palm Sunday.
So we all have tasks to do by Palm Sunday.
Yes.
Not to mention right in the sermon.
I got one too. Palm Sunday, that's me. All right, anything else? If not?
Oh yeah. Marcia's not here, is she? Can we sing her happy birthday?
Maybe that's why she's not here.
She's pre-partying. I have friends who have birthday months. They just start the month partying and just move on all the way through.
So we're all going to sing happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Marcia. Happy birthday to you.
Very good.
This is your birthday song. It isn't very long.
That's it.
Okay. We have a note on here.
Sing hymns?
All right, so let's stand up and sing our opening hymn.
Thank you. be seated and join me in the call to worship. Dawn is breaking. Christ's light is shining.
Light of the world shines in our lives.
Put aside the cares of the night.
In the Lord, we live in the light.
Even in the darkest valley, God illuminates our path.
Even in times of despair, hope shines forth.
Sleeper, awake! Christ's light is shining.
The light of the world shines in our lives.
And please join me in the prayer of invocation.
Light of all lights, be our vision this day. Open our eyes to behold your glory. Open hearts to the warmth of your love. Open minds to the flame of your truth. Open our souls to the glory of living as children of light, that others may see in our living the sacred mystery of your kingdom. Amen.
First reading today is from Samuel chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely his anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send him and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel set out and went to Ramah. The second reading is Psalm 23. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
Today's gospel comes from Mark, I think, or John. John. I'm having one of those days. I know. Physical therapy does work. It's just a pain in the behind. Literally, in my case. All right, back to being serious, because it is true. Jesus heard that they had driven him out. And when he found them, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" And he answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him." And Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, the one you have seen him, the one that is speaking to you is he." Jesus said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. And Jesus said, "I came into the world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those that do see may become blind." And some of the Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and said, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" And Jesus said to them, "You are blind. You would not have sin. But now that you say we see, your sin remains." Excuse me, I'm going to strip. I'm hot. No, I think right now I am totally fine. Thank you, everybody who has helped. The title of this sermon is, "Are You a Lamb or a Lemon?" That's an odd title for a sermon, isn't it? Are you a lamb or a lemming? First of all, how many know what a lemming is? There's some that do and some that don't. Okay, a lemon is a little rodent-type creature. Same family as mice and rats and all that kind of jazz. Cute, but they don't have much in the upstairs area. Lemons are known for being totally dependent on their lead lemming to lead them in every direction they go, even if it means off a cliff. If the lead lemming decides to take a leap, the whole crew does. There used to be a game back in the, it's got to be like the early 80s, where you would try to keep the lemmings from going off the cliff or something, and you'd see this whole troop go, and then like what you didn't want is for everybody to go. And I didn't realize until many years later that lemmings were actual creatures. A lamb, we all know what a lamb is. A lamb is this cute little fuzzy-wuzzy thing that wool eventually comes from when they gets big, gets shorn. And a lamb tends to follow a one leader. Well, two kind of, because it follows a lead lamb, but that lead lamb follows the shepherd. Okay? Now that you've had your arithmetic lesson for the day, what am I talking about here? Are you a lamb of God? Are you a lamb who follows God? Or are you a lemming that will do whatever your religious leader says, regardless of the fact they're doing God's will or not? And we could take that to other areas of life and the world. But right now I'm going to talk about primarily learning how to let God lead you and become a lamb whose shepherd is Jesus, or becoming a lemming who says, he's the leader of my church, he knows what's best, I'm going to do this. In the last scripture I read, it talked about the Pharisees. Well, they were the church leaders, right? In those days. They were who you were to listen to. They were who you made your sacrifices that they would take and give to the Lord as sacrifices. You brought your doves or your lambs or whatever, and they would take it and up. Everything depended on what the Pharisees said. That caused problems. It caused a lot of people to not understand that a Savior was coming. Because in my belief, my thoughts, not anywhere written, the Pharisees really didn't want the Messiah to come. Because then if the Messiah came, then they wouldn't be in charge anymore. They liked that control. And whether you were a Pharisee or Sadducee, and we all know, my favorite joke about the Sadducees, I'm sure you've heard a billion times. Why are the Sadducees sad? They're Sadducee because they don't believe in resurrection. That was an old joke. I heard it in the camp one year, and it's true. Sadducees did not believe in an afterlife, a resurrection. So depending on who you followed, that's what you believed. Well, now, Jesus came, and people were listening to the Pharisees. Oh, he can't be God. He can't be the Son of God. He can't be the Messiah, and they had all these reasons why. Look, he healed. Oh my goodness, he healed on a Sabbath. What's more important, healing a man or keeping the Sabbath? Jesus told us and reminded us that the Sabbath was made for man, not the man made for Sabbath. So man comes before Sabbath, right? So, how do you stop being a lemming, the one who just blindly does whatever? And I'm not picking on any particular group. So, but it's just out there. I'll give you an example of my life. My father, he didn't go to church most of my growing up, primarily because of his work schedule. For one thing, he was gone 2 weeks at a time. He was he worked in the construction department for the Kresge Kmart Corporation, and it was his job to go and inspect all the stores around the country and in Puerto Rico, so he traveled a lot. So a lot of times his takeoff days were on Sunday. So he didn't go to church. He had to pack to get ready to go. But he always, you know, made sure that mom made sure that we all kids went and everything. But when I got older and was having a discussion with him, I said, Dad, how much Bible studying do you do? He goes, I don't read the Bible. I'm a Christian. That's enough. And Dad, why don't you read the Bible? I don't have to. The pastor does it. He grew up as a child in a small Kentucky town. We're talking about the next biggest town had one traffic light. And the second biggest town had two traffic lights. So Dad was town was smaller than those two. And they had one church for the whole town. And basically, it was a Baptist preacher who said, you don't need to read, you need to listen. I don't know what he taught them. I don't even know if Dad knew when he died what that preacher taught him. All he knew is that he was told, the preacher reads the Bible, we don't have to. And he almost got in trouble about that because he, later in life, someone handed him the Book of Mormon and said, this is the second half of the Bible. Well, you know, Dad started to read it and read about a chapter of it and decided that the Mormons were okay. I said, Dad, how do you know they believe what you believe? He goes, because it's the first couple of pages in the book sounded right. If you just leave out the thinking to everybody else, my dad was an extremely intelligent man, even though he only went through 10th grade actual in high school. He actually worked his way up the ladder to get to be president of the construction department of the, well, he was in charge of the whole building of construction workers in Troy. But he was very intelligent and usually to work things out and did tons of reading. So I don't understand why he wouldn't read the Bible. But in order for you to make sure that you're following the shepherd and not someone who's going to lead you off a stray path, is to read your Bible. I meant to have mine here today. It's not mandatory, or is it? How do you know the Lord's will if you're not reading your Bible? I know that this church has a Tuesday afternoons, a Bible study, and it's a good one. I don't make it, I can't make it right now, and I would have liked to have made it more when I was in, but I, you know, just no excuses, it just didn't fit the time schedule for me. It just didn't. But if you want to be, you're not good about reading the Bible, join a Bible study. Where are you guys in right now?
Exodus.
It's a great way to get an in-depth look at the book of whatever book they're studying. It's thorough. It makes you study, makes you read that part of the Bible, it makes you write down answers and think about it. Because part of reading your Bible is not just reading it. It's thinking about it. It's applying it to your life. Your life today. If you can't fit a Bible study into your life, you need to do one by yourself. And it can be, you can start out with one as simple as it gives a scripture, you read that scripture, it gives you a little talk about it in a way, or prayer, a poem about it, and it gives you, leads you in a prayer. And it takes maybe 10, 15 minutes. Certainly you can fit that into your life. Today's society has made it very difficult for us to spend the amount of time we should want to be with the Lord. We need praise time, we need prayer time, and we need study time. It took a long time for a certain church that I used to belong to really understand that one of its members was doing a great job of leading everybody off course. And the reason was, in this particular denomination, they didn't They had so many restrictions on stuff that basically everybody just left it to the person preaching that Sunday to know what they were doing. And there wasn't, per se, one particular preacher. They had different people at times come up and preach, but you had to be at least an elder to preach. And even the other elders didn't realize how wrong they were until someone new came in and said, show me in the Bible where it says that. Well, it must say that. Just like home. It may say that. It has to, because he said it did. Now, this sermon isn't one of my greatest or best, and that's not what I'm here for anyways. If this congregation is to grow, if this congregation is to truly follow the shepherd, we need to know what we're talking about. Now, I would think it's fair to say, and you may not agree, but that the leadership you have right now in this church is following the shepherd. I know the consistory board is focused on what does God want us to do next. I know that Nina and I are focused on what does God want for this church. Because not only do we love God and we want to follow Jesus and we want to do what is best for the best in his eyes, we love this congregation. And we want to make sure that every single one of you is following the shepherd, is not making decisions on what Nina and I say, or Jim, or Charlie, or anyone says. But the decisions you make have to be made by your knowledge of God and what the Bible says and what paths we're following. I thank God daily that this church is not full of lemmings. Now, in this case, you probably won't end up off a cliff, even if you're just following Nina and I blindly. But you never know when someone else is going to come in. And if you don't know and don't understand what you should be doing, you might just be let off a cliff. We're coming up on faster than I'd like to admit, Good Friday. Palm Sunday, Good Friday. We only about passed out last night when the newscaster said, well, you know it's only 3 weeks till Sunday, Easter Sunday. I don't know where the time went because I was stoned off of it, but at any rate, my prayer for all of you is that you come to know and love Jesus as your Savior, yes, but as your shepherd. Do you know why sheep follow shepherds? I'll tell you why. I looked it up. The reason sheep follow shepherd, their shepherd is, the shepherd guides them with love, with encouragement, and with understanding. A shepherd knows each of his lambs, his sheep. He knows how to talk to each one in a way that will make that lamb, that sheep, feel safe and comfortable. And our shepherd Jesus does the same, doesn't he? I've told this before, I've never known a day that I didn't believe in Jesus. And the main reason, I think, was because when I was a baby, in and out of the hospital for the first year, being saved, because I had severe asthma and quit breathing a few times, might explain the brain cells, but I believe that Jesus was there beside me. And as an infant, I understood that. Now, not everybody's blessed with something like that, but everybody should have a personal relationship with Jesus. And when you have that personal relationship with Jesus, you know what it says in the 23rd Psalm, even though you walk through the shadow of death, I know that thou art with me. And he was. When you think about it, it says, my table is set before my enemies. He's taking care of you. Honestly, lemmings, the only one who even thinks is the leader, and he's only doing what he wants to do. He doesn't care a flick about the people behind him. In my opinion, you don't need to make a big fuss or declaration. You just need to ask Jesus to walk with you. In a book I'm reading, it said that you should make him your partner. It's a book about business, so business partner. Whether you're in business or not, if you make Jesus your partner in life, as far as making decisions and stuff, and you handle it like, Lord, not asking him to give you the answers, but Lord, what do you think about? Where should I head? What's your opinion? It's kind of interesting the turn your life can take with that. Because all of a sudden you're having a one-on-one relationship with Jesus. A little more often than you might think. So if you haven't asked Jesus to be your Savior, if you haven't thanked him for giving his life on the cross for you, if you haven't really opened up your heart to him, do so. If you need help or guidance in your walk with God, Pastor Nine is right there. I'm here. A lot of people here have a good relationship with Christ and can help you. You just gotta ask. You don't need to broadcast it. That's your choice and your decision how you wanna handle it. But please know that if for some reason you out there on video land or anyone here hasn't been as close to Jesus as they needed to be, or felt they should be or want to be, it's never, ever, ever, ever too late to accept Jesus as your Savior. So as we go forth this last few weeks of Lent, if you're not a Bible reader, try just reading a verse a day. I suggest you start in John. It's the love chapter. But anywhere will do. Psalms is good, wisdom. Just get your face in the book. Let the book be your visual to the shepherd. And let the lemmings go on their merry way. Amen. Okay.
Yeah.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication.
Thank you, God, for your many blessings to us. Accept now our tithes and offerings. Use us and our gifts for your kingdom. Amen.
Do I have any other prayer requests? You may be seated. Okay. Prayer from Kelly. Safe travels for Tony, who's going to Oklahoma and Florida. Those are not in the same area.
No, they aren't.
Also for Kelly, who's been forgetful of stuff all weekend. I've been forgetful of stuff for years.
Yeah, really. Yeah. Also, Tony.
Just wait, it gets more fun.
Along with that, travels for Tony, I don't want to forget. Tony will be gone, so Kelly will not have a ride to church next Sunday. If there's anyone that we can get her a ride, please let her know, talk with her. We need to have that exuberance of her and Kenny here.
And prayer from Sarah. Her brother is in the hospital, and her sister-in-law got stuck in a snowbank and spent the night in her car.
Oh, wow.
Fortunately, on the way home from the grocery store, so she wasn't going to starve to death. But it did take the state police a little while to get to her. And prayers for the people of Peru and Ecuador, who had a significant earthquake this morning. Hopefully Machu Picchu is all right, because I don't want to see it tumbled down.
Before you can get there.
Yeah.
I have a praise report. This week in physical therapy, I was told the bad point is I'll have to be in physical therapy from eight weeks to, you know, total to 12 weeks total. But the progress that I am making, they are confident that they can get me off the walker, but I have to use a cane, one of those four-legged canes. And I find that a praise.
Woo! Yay!
So very soon, hopefully in the next month or two, the walker can go back till I'm about 85 or 90.
Yeah.
So anyways.
And a great joy. We had LaRue with us this morning. Woo! And Dan and Carol and... Who's this young, lovely young lady next to you, LaRue?
My granddaughter, Stacy.
And your granddaughter, Stacy. Welcome to St. Paul's. Yeah. It's good to have you here.
Yeah, we know her parents well. And I just love, you know, the fact that you came in and got family there. When will you be traveling back? Okay, so safe.
So safe travels for Carol and Dan as they head back to Wisconsin.
And Stacy too.
And Stacy.
Yeah, we don't want to.
Yeah. Okay. Would you all pray with me? Eternal and loving God, we come before you today in a spirit of gratefulness and celebration. We all got up this morning and opened our eyes. And for that, we are grateful. We pray for those who have struggled with the ravages of weather and the movement of the earth. Those who are struggling through floods and massive snowstorms. But we pray that they will see the blessing in it, as it may help alleviate some of the drought conditions from which they have been suffering. For those recovering from the earthquake, we pray that they will be safe. For the workers who have come in for rescue, let them find those who have survived and bring them safely out. Gracious God, we continue to remember the people of Ukraine who continue to fight for their nation and for their independence. Loving God, for all those who suffer from mental health concerns, we pray your loving touch. So many times it is not understood, and it is dismissed or belittled, and yet we know that it is real. We pray for wisdom for the medical people, for those who would work with them and assist them. Loving God, for all of those who will be on the road these coming days, we pray that you will keep them safe. Give them wisdom as they travel. Hold them safely in your hands and bring them back to us. And now, loving God, hear these, the silent prayers of your people as they offer them to you. And now, loving God, we ask that you hear the prayer that your child talked to each of his disciples. As he said, Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily prayer,
and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Shall we all stand for the communion hymn? Which is... seated. A long time ago, Jesus reclined at the table with his followers, and he said to them as he took the bread and broke it, "This is my body I give for you. Take, eat, and remember." In the same way, he took the wine, and he said, "This is my blood. Drink it and remember of me, for I shed it for you." Don't think they understood, but we do. The wine and the bread, take and eat. And join us for our final hymn.
Thank you.
Lord be with you this week. May you follow your shepherd and listen to his call. May the Lord take your peace and spread it to all those that are near you. Amen.
Amen.
And now, let's let there be peace. Peace.